the day in continuation of our 71 war heroes respecting or remembering service kind of program which we have commenced from 16th December last year. So there is, we feel proud of the fact that to start with this program, as you all know, JW Patexar is it is his dream. Under the guidance from today's chief guest, our Air Marshal Avinash Devadatta Joshi sir. So he is a PVSM and Vice Honor Medal, and also mentioned in dispatch for gallantry. He has got three awards to his credit. So under his auspices, we have been able to move through with this excellent program, inviting all our war heroes and sharing their respective stories of valor during the course of 71 war. So we should all welcome our today's guest, Air Marshal Joshi sir. So because he is in fact, he has been the godfather for this program through our Patek Garu. So welcome sir. I may introduce sir. Joshi sir, welcome. We welcome our Air Marshal Joshi sir, and we salute your services for the nation. So glorious services. So I may just run through his about his brief profile part of it with your permission, with our Air Marshal Joshi sir's permission. Sir, are you there? Today's guest, you all know, Air Marshal Avinash Devadatta Joshi, PVSM, Vice Honor Medal, and mentioned dispatches. Born on 20th December 1946, joined in Indian Air Force on 16th December 1964, commissioned on 16th November 1967, and served more than 39 and a half years, and retired on 31st December 2006 as Air Marshal. So he, even in his training also, he has been the brilliant trainee. So landed his solo flight record within 1 hour 15 minutes. That is the record for him to land solo flying within 1 hour 15 minutes. He was best in flying in all stages during training. Commissioned in fighter stream with 3,800 flying hours on various fighter aircraft, flown Hindustan Trainer 2, T-6G Texan, Vampire, Hunter, HJT-16, that is Kiran all variants, MiG-21 all four variants, MiG-23 Bomber, MiG-23 Air Defense, besides Mirage 2000 and Su-3 sorties as well. His major achievements include taking active part in 1971 Indo-Pak War and getting the award of mention in dispatches for his gallantry. Then he was the first pilot to carry out night flying in Srinagar and clear other pilots. And also he proceeded to USSR to train MiG-23 bomber striker aircraft. First MiG-23 pilot to carry out landing and takeoff from the highest operational airfield in Ladakh, that is Leh. So he also carried out photo recce of enemy areas during Kargil and Siachen glacier area, during Operation Magdoot in April 1984 and 87, and he was awarded the gallantry award of Vice Sena Medal during that time. He was first to carry out high altitude armament trials, bombing, rocket and gun attacks at targets in 1986-87, and then train other units. As AOC Air Force Station Bidar, he was responsible for raising the Surya Kiran aerobatics team. He was the qualified flying instructor and also a qualified fighter bomb combat leader, which is a rare combination and very few achieved that feat. So attended higher command army course at MAU and qualified for MPhil in military science, and later posted as Air Force directing staff in the Faculty of Studies at Army War College, MAU. So he also attended 38th course at National Defense College, New Delhi. He participant of Combined Operational Review and Evaluation Program conducted for two-star officers of all the three services. He also attended the National Security Program at Galilee College, that is Haifa in Israel, in 2002. So the prestigious posts he held included He commanded a MiG-23 BN squadron specialized in mountain ranges. And also he was the station commander of Air Force Station Uttarlai, Rajasthan. And he was also AOC Air Force Station Bidar, a flying training establishment. He was also the deputy commandant, College of Air Warfare, Secunderabad. Then assistant CAS, flight safety and inspections. Assistant ACAS, personnel officers. SAS of SWAC as Air Marshal in 2004. AOC in C, EAC in November 2004, till August 2005. And he was also the Commander-in-Chief of the Strategic Forces Command, SFC, from 22nd August 2005 until his retirement on 31st December 2006. That's after 39 and a half years of glorious commissioned service in Indian Air Force. So his awards include, as I already mentioned dispatches, Vaisena Medal, PVSM, and he was also appointed as Honorary ADS to President in March 2006, and as also was Commodore Commandant of number 221 Squadron Air Force, and led a delegation to USSR in 2003 and also to China in 2004. This has been his glorious service in Indian Air Force. So I think very few achieve all these milestones in service. So we all should feel proud of him and respect his, particularly his gallantry services during 71 war. Let's all welcome with a big round of applause. So we all salute you, sir. Remember your services during war and throughout your journey of almost four decades as a glorious service in Indian Air Force, sir. So now I would like to request on behalf of all our participants to take us through your journey, starting from your childhood. What was the motivation to join in Indian Air Force from that point onwards? So we can carry on, sir.
Thank you so much, Rao. Thank you very much, sir, for the introduction.
Welcome, sir.
Can you all hear me? Okay. To begin with, like you said about childhood days, well, I was born in Pune. My father was an engineer. He wanted to join the army, but somebody told him that the MES was going to start. So the military engineering service was part of the army engineers. And he was posted all over, and initially in Pune when I was born. At that time, he was the garrison engineer of the now what you call the CME. That is, the College of Military Engineering was built under his jurisdiction. And I went to school initially over here in St. Helena's and then into St. Vincent's. Then when he got posted out to Visakhapatnam, I did 1 year in Visakhapatnam initially, and then I was sent as a boarder to the Hyderabad Public School at Begumpet, where I studied for 2 years. He was then posted to Cochin, and then I joined him in Cochin and did another 2 years there.
Okay.
Subsequently, he came back to Pune. And from Pune, where I did my schooling in Bishop's High School, and then moved to Nagpur, where in Nagpur I finished my higher secondary. And I was at that time, you know, like everybody knows, that you could bifurcate into the engineering branch or the medical branch in the class 9 itself.
Yes, sir.
So I had bifurcated to the medical branch. After passing out, I went to college and did my pre-medical, but I found it extremely difficult. I could not have coped up with the medical branch.
Yes, sir.
And I told my father at that time, you see, my motivation was mainly towards the defense forces. I took part actively in the NCC army in school, and I was actively involved with the naval NCC in college.
Sir.
And I also did my C certificate.
Oh.
So at that time, I had no clue about the Indian Air Force as such, except that there was a squadron leader, Birch, who was the commanding officer of the NCC, who happened to be my father's friend. And I asked him, I said, what is this Air Force all about? Because in my father's movements, we never actually had anything to do with the Air Force as such. It was basically Army and Navy. So In the meantime, 62 war had taken place, and they had started asking for people to join the various services. And I decided to choose the Air Force because of Squadron Leader Birch, who was then the commanding officer of the NCC Air Wing there. Fortunately, got through. And I'm very happy that I didn't have to go into the medical branch, because I would have been a very bad doctor.
Okay. Yes, sir.
I joined the Air Force on call on 16 November 1964 at Coimbatore, which was the Air Force Administrative College.
Yes, sir.
And we were given the initial grounding of basics of, you know, various subjects related to flying.
Sir.
As well as mathematics and various other subjects.
Sir.
After we finished our training there, we were in the meantime then sent to what you call the elementary flying training units.
Sir.
The elementary flying training units were civilian units, actually. I mean, they were civil aircraft. But there was a CO who was a wing commander there. He had a flight lieutenant over there. And we did the initial training in one of these AFUs, out of which there were six of them.
Sir.
So we were all split into groups, and I was sent to Nagpur.
Okay.
So I was in Nagpur elementary flying training unit, and we were flying the L5 at that time. So the L5 is a very small aircraft, like the Pushpak or something like that, but the L5 was a better aircraft than the Pushpak.
Okay.
And we had civilian instructors. And there also, I did my first solo in a very short period of time, and which is a record in Nagpur EFTU also.
Okay, great, sir.
And there also, when the final test was done by the wing commander who was posted there. And he was very happy with my performance. And in fact, he told me that you have done the best.
Sure.
In the meantime, the 65 war thing had started.
Okay.
The Kutch operations had started, and they didn't know what to do with us, because one course was stuck in Allahabad. The other course was stuck in Jodhpur.
Sir.
The other course was stuck in at Hakimpet.
Three different places.
Yeah, they were all senior courses.
Okay.
So we were then sent on a little leave. And then we were, once we got back, so somewhere I finished my flying sometime in April 1965. And then we just sat on the ground doing guard duties and things like that. When aircraft were passing through, we went to Allahabad for a short period of time and did guard duties there. And then we were sent on leave again.
Okay.
And then when the war finished in September, we were then called to report to Allahabad.
Sir.
Which was the pilot's training establishment.
Sir.
Which was the first training establishment of the Air Force, you can say. The flying training establishment.
Okay, sir.
That is when we were flying the Hindustan Trainer 2, which was the HT-2.
Sir.
We reported there, and sometime in November, the flying started after doing the ground tests and things of that kind. And I had an instructor called Flight Lieutenant David.
Okay, sir.
Now, Flight Lieutenant David, I did my first sortie, and the second sortie, he sent me solo.
Achha,
which was
okay.
1 hour and 45 minutes, which is the record over there.
Okay.
In Allahabad, because nobody had gone in their second sortie up till now.
Achha, and that's great, sir. That's great.
Subsequently, another instructor who was Squadron Leader Sadanand, he was the flight commander, and he said, I'm going to fly with this boy.
Okay.
So I was shifted from Flight Lieutenant David to Flight Squadron Leader Sadanand. And I remained with him. And I got the flying trophy at Allahabad also.
That's great, sir. For best in flying, sir?
Beg your pardon?
For best in flying.
For best in flying.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Subsequently, after finishing flying over there, we went on to Jodhpur. Where we flew the Howard, I flew the Texan. There was the Howard, normal old Howard, and the Howard Texan. So I flew the Howard Texan. And we flew about 70-75 hours over there. I went up for the flying trophy, but somebody else beat me to it.
Okay.
I lost it over there.
Okay.
That is where the course got bifurcated.
I see, sir. Okay.
We went on to fighters, transports, and helicopters.
Sir.
So I had chosen fighters. And we were then sent to Hakimpet.
Sir.
So where we flew the Vampire aircraft.
Sir.
And at that particular time, my co-pupil was Paramvir Chakra winner, N.S. Sekhon.
Okay.
We were both co-pupils of the same instructor.
That's great. Okay.
He was and then a flight lieutenant Bhalla.
Okay.
A very tough guy.
Sir.
Just to say, Sekhon is to get thrashed every time. I was lucky not to be thrashed, but abused, yes. Plenty of abuses.
Sir, part of the training.
Part of the training. It was yes, part sir. Of the training.
Sir.
And he was very tough. And being a Punjabi, he knew a lot of abuses. So it was quite hilarious at the same time. But well, we had to keep taking it.
So how was the flying of the second was doing, sir, along with you in the training?
No, we didn't fly together.
Sir.
We were flying with the instructor, but he was good. He was a good flyer.
Sir.
And subsequently, by the time we finished our training,
sir.
Which was actually, we had finished our training by about March itself of 67.
Sir.
But by that time, the orders had come that the passing out parades will now be held only in June and December.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So that is how we got stuck from March 67 till June 67.
Oh, for 3 months.
Yeah. And we were doing only parades after that.
Okay.
And 4th of June, sir. 4th of June 67 is when our course passed out. And that is when we passed out at Hakimpet.
Sir.
Which means that all the people who were being trained at Yalanka, the transports,
sir.
And at Begumpet, and the helicopter chaps also, they were being trained at Allahabad. So they all joined up in Hakimpet at our passing out parade. And the passing out parade was attended by the defense minister, Sardar Swaran Singh.
Sir.
After we had finished our training, then we came again, as all of us got posted to Pune.
Yes, sir.
Which was now to two different squadrons.
Sir.
They were 220 and 221.
Sir.
Now, I got posted to 220 squadron initially.
Okay, sir.
This was basically again on Vampires. And thereafter, we did the applied course, where we did some firing and all on the ranges. And on completion of this, we were posted to our regular squadrons.
Sir.
Now, I got posted to 27th Squadron in April 1968.
68, yes, sir.
Okay. And I remained with 27th Squadron right up to June 1974.
Oh, okay.
I did a very long 6.5 year tenure over there.
Sir.
Now, that is when we reported to Halwara, which 27th Squadron was in Halwara.
Sir.
And we had a very good CO at that time, a Wing Commander M.N. Singh.
Okay, sir.
A highly operational man. And they were very good flight commanders. There was now the late S.V. Bhutani, Group Captain Bhutani, who was then a squadron leader.
Sir.
Then we had squadron leader Rana, R.S. Rana, who was a Sardar. And there was one more person, he got posted out at the time when I arrived. But the only problem was that there were so many pilots over there. We were almost 35 pilots.
Sir.
So getting flying itself was a little difficult.
Okay. Uh-huh.
We were made to sit on the ground because now what the 27th Squadron had was the more modern hunters.
Sir.
There were the two types of hunters. One was the Mark 56.
Sir.
which was a lesser powered aircraft, and there was a Mark 56A,
sir,
which was the more powerful aircraft,
sir.
So now the biggest problem was that we were at that time required to do certain number of flying hours to get our flying boundary. We had to do 6 hours a month.
Sir.
Only then we could get our flying boundary. Now it is a flying pay, which is part of your pay.
Sir.
In those days, it was called flying boundary.
Okay.
So we had no choice how to get those flying hours. So we used to be sent to, you know, transport squadrons.
Okay.
Where we used to go from Halwara, we used to go to Chandigarh.
Okay.
And do flying with the AN-12s over there.
Sir.
To get our flying hours basically, so that we could qualify for the flying hours, the bounty.
So all the fighters can fly the bomber, I mean this transport aircraft, sir?
Pardon?
All the fighter pilots can fly the transport aircrafts also?
No. We were just supernumerary pilots over there.
Okay.
Not regular. I mean, we were not part of the actual thing. We used to be sitting. Sometimes they used to give you the controls in your hand.
Achha, okay, sir.
But not, since we were not really qualified.
Co-pilot kind.
But we were not really qualified on that type, you know. So,
achha. I mean, okay.
So we can't really. We were called supernumerary pilots.
Achha, okay, sir. Okay.
Then subsequently, in 1969, actually, there was a long break, about almost a year. When our flying started on Hunters.
Sir.
And by that time, what had happened was that people had started getting posted to MiGs and Sukhois.
Sir.
The Su-7 had just come in, the MiGs were already there, but the number of squadrons had increased.
Sir.
So the senior lot started going to these squadrons, and the junior lot started then getting progressed onto the Hunter aircraft.
Okay.
So we started flying generally from 1969 and did our operational, whatever we are supposed to do, operational flying. And we were declared operational on our aircraft.
Okay.
So in those days, there were hardly any restrictions and all that. No, I mean, you could become a 2-aircraft leader, you could become a 4-aircraft leader.
Okay.
Even as a flying officer.
Achha, okay.
But now there are restrictions. Now you have to be a certain rank, you have to have a certain amount of flowers, you know, flying hours.
Flying hours, yes, sir.
All those restrictions came up much later.
Yes, sir.
So, by the time we were fully operational, we became 2-aircraft leaders and 4-aircraft leaders.
Sir.
And we used to do operational, the operation that ORP duties over there.
Sir.
Now, in 1971,
sir.
The CO of our CO got posted out.
Who was your CO, sir?
The CO I told you was Wing Command M.N. Singh.
Yes, sir.
And for 3 years running under him,
sir,
27th Squadron got the best squadron of the Indian Air Force.
Oh, okay.
All 3 years.
Yes, sir.
And then he got posted out, and we got a new CO, Wing Commander Y.P. Mehta.
Yes, sir.
Who had come from Iraq.
Oh, okay.
He took over sometime in March, sir, of 71.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the meantime, a lot of our flight commanders started going out. And by the time, Bangladesh operations had already started.
Okay, sir. Okay.
You know, things had started. I mean, the Pakistanis had started taking their action in what they call East Pakistan.
So from March, April onwards.
I mean, yes. So we knew that something would be happening. I mean, something might happen. I mean, we were not sure whether anything would happen.
Yes, sir.
Whether we would get involved or not, we was not sure.
Okay, sir.
Then subsequently, since I was already married in 1970.
Sir.
And my daughter was born in June of 71.
Okay. Uh-huh.
I had gone on leave during, sir, that particular period of time.
Sir.
And when I got back to Halwara,
sir,
I was shocked because the squadron had already moved out to Pathankot.
Okay. Uh-huh.
But we were not informed about it.
Okay. No communication, sir.
No communication at all.
Okay.
That the squadron has moved to Pathankot.
Sir.
And three of us were on leave at that time.
Sir.
And all three of us landed up in Halwara and found Sukhois over there.
Okay.
So we said, where is our squadron gone?
Sir.
So they said, your squadron has moved to Pathankot.
Mm-hmm.
So now suddenly packing up and everything and then leaving for Pathankot.
Sir.
So we reached Pathankot and things like that. And fortunately, we did have houses. And our flying training started off in that area of Pathankot, because that was more close to the mountainous terrain.
Yes, sir.
You see, here it was more towards the Punjab plains.
Yes, sir.
And there it was more towards the mountainous terrain.
Yes, sir.
And so flying training had to, you know, suddenly switch from training in the plains to training in mountains.
Mountains, yes, sir.
And we carried on as normal. And sometime in October, that is 14th of October to be actual.
Sir.
We had already finished our flying for the day, had gone home.
Sir.
And suddenly at about 3 o'clock, somebody came from the mess and banged on the door and said, you are required in the squadron immediately.
Sir.
So all of us, were called to the squadron. There was no air, no siren or anything given. It was just that word of mouth said, go to the squadron immediately.
Sir.
So we all landed up in the squadron.
Mm-hmm.
And there was the flight commander saying, aircraft number so-and-so, take it and go. But go where?
Okay.
So then we were told you are going to Ambala.
Sir.
So all of us, 20 squadron as well as 27 squadron,
sir,
we were all shifted out. And we had to fly out to Ambala.
Sir.
And we all landed up there. By evening, we were there in Ambala, not knowing what was happening.
Sir.
And we were trying to find out as to what was the reason for all this.
Sir.
Next morning, we were told by the CO that, you see, there was some interception of intelligence that had taken place, that there were likely to be a commando raid over Pathankot.
Okay. Uh-huh.
They wanted to destroy the aeroplanes.
Okay.
So the action was taken accordingly.
Okay, sir.
Mm-hmm. And we continued to stay in Ambala,
sir,
for almost a week with all our family still in
Pathankot itself.
Sir. Then subsequently, can you see me?
Yeah, I can see you, sir. I can see.
And then on 20th of October, we got back, our squadron got back to Pathankot.
Sir.
Now WAC decided that one squadron will stay in Ambala.
Sir.
And the second squadron will continue in Pathankot.
Sir.
So we continued in Pathankot as 27th squadron.
Sir.
And we would once in a while come to Ambala.
Sir.
Then sometime in November,
sir,
we were informed that your squadron, that is 27th squadron, is going to be a night strike squadron.
Okay.
So we had to concentrate more on night flying.
Sir.
Now in between, what was happening was that people had already started getting posts out, especially the senior lot.
Okay, sir.
And new people started coming in. Now, sometime you could say from September, October onwards, just before the war started.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a squad leader Hingorani who had come in.
Sir.
We had Sondi.
Sir.
Then we had squad leader M.K. Jain who came in.
All new officers.
All new.
Sir.
And the only person called it a Rana.
Sir.
Who old timer had been sent for his Sukh conversion.
Acha.
So he had gone for Sukhoi conversion.
Sir.
So starting from CO who had taken over in March.
Sir.
And all the flight commanders who were posted out.
Sir.
We got absolutely brand new people.
Okay, sir.
There were so few flight lieutenants, but they had already spent a year with the squadron.
Sir.
So what started happening was that you had to start you know, becoming a team again.
Yes, sir.
Now, so now what started happening was, once we were told that we are going to be a night strike squadron, mm-hmm. We were only flying throughout the night.
Okay.
And daytime we were relaxing, you know, to get our rest and recuperation.
Sure.
So at night on as an individual aircraft, but we had to go through, you know, formation flying also at night. We had to do all kinds of things at night.
Sure.
And in those days,
sure.
the runway was just a runway.
Okay, sir.
There was no, unlike people who see now or from the new generation, you will see sand patches on either side of the runway known as the soft ground arrestors.
Sure.
You know, there was, in case the aircraft went off the runway, he would go into sand. But mm-hmm. in those days, that was not there.
Sir.
Then there was no painting of the runway white, which is now painted white for you to see.
Yes, sir.
Now people all the pilots are getting used to this new white patch, which is there. So you can, from a distance, you can see that this is the runway. See.
Yes, sir.
No, but we couldn't see it in those days. It was just the runway.
Sir.
On top of that, an experiment was tried out that let us see that if we switch off the runway lights, will you be able to land where 2-3 tonners lights are put on the dumbbell?
Oh, okay.
There were no lights.
Sir, uh-huh.
Of course, it was moon phase. The moon was there.
Sir.
But two lights, you know, after 2-3 tonners on either side, make an approach on the runway.
Okay.
Which was getting difficult for you to get depth perception and thing like that. It was not easy.
Yes, sir.
Anyway, these were all experiments that were being tried out at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But we were doing long range strikes, that is, we were taking off from Halwar, Pathankot, striking as far as Sirsa, Nal.
Acha, okay.
Long distance. Or taking off from Pathankot and striking Hindon.
Okay, coming far off places.
Yeah, far off places, because we were supposed to do long, you know, attacks, airfields of Pakistan.
Pakistan, yes, sir. Uh-huh.
We had to get used to, you know, navigating at night.
Sir.
And, you know, finding the runway as it is.
Okay.
Locating the runway.
Okay.
So, you know, things to make it difficult was, the target runway was told, don't switch on your lights.
Uh-huh. Achha.
So, we would navigate up to that.
Mm-hmm.
And say, releasing bombs now.
Mm-hmm.
And then they would put the light on.
Achha. Okay, after action completed.
So you would know as to where exactly you would have dropped your bombs.
Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
You know, we were not too sure because we didn't have GPS.
This technology.
We had a novel map.
Yes, sir.
We didn't have a navigation, inertial navigation platforms like what the modern aircraft have.
Sir.
And we were flying the aircraft, there was no autopilot.
Sir.
So you had only a compass,
mm-hmm.
your map, and your time.
Mm-hmm.
And you were going purely on those kind of things. And later on, we kept practicing like this, but we were flying during the daytime also.
Okay.
Probably, command realized that it may not work out at night like this.
Okay.
So we were back to the daytime training.
Daytime practices, yes, sir.
Back to daytime training. Now, sometime during the end of November,
sir,
I was sent as the range safety officer to the Sidwa Khan's range, which was near Halwara.
Sir.
So I went to Halwara, and then I was the range officer there. And I was at Halwara. On the third evening.
Oh, okay.
And my wife was at that time at Pathankot itself.
Okay.
Along with my small baby dog.
Yes, sir.
Now, on third, I was supposed to get back on the fourth itself after my TD was over.
Sir.
But third night, while we were sitting outside,
sir.
Suddenly the air raid siren went off.
Yes, sir.
And we had heard that Pakistan has attacked,
sir,
these airfields.
Yes, sir.
And my house was quite very close to the runway, actually.
Okay.
I was very worried because I was wondering
about the family. Yes, sir.
The family.
Sir.
So I went up to the station commander. He was then Group Captain Gole.
Sir.
And I told him, sir, I have to get back to my squadron.
Sir.
So he said, no, you are not traveling at night.
Sir.
You can leave tomorrow morning.
Sir.
Now, actually speaking, the whole night was very difficult to pass.
Yes, sir.
I was quite awake with a few of the other officers.
Sir.
And we saw the first Canberra raid coming in over Halwara.
Okay.
And we saw this aircraft doing the first bombing run.
Sir.
Then doing a turn and coming for the second run where he fired his guns. And we were watching him throughout.
So did we not have any initial intimation, sir, about that impending raid? Was there no intelligence?
I think the air raid siren went off.
Okay.
We were sitting in our rooms. Actually, we were in our rooms only.
So no intelligence for us, sir?
Well, the war had started. So it was like standard intelligence would come in.
Yes, sir.
And the Alwara did give the air raid siren.
Sir.
That means the radar must have told them that there was an air raid.
Sir.
But we saw the aircraft come and do the bombing run and things of that kind.
Okay.
Then we heard that the SAM-2 missile had been fired against that
aircraft.
Against the Canberra.
Sir.
Pakistani Canberra.
Sir.
Well, after that, next morning, early morning at about 4:35, I left Halwara.
Sir.
Fortunately, I did. There was one of the three tunnels going towards Ludhiana.
Okay.
I got into the three tunnel.
Sir.
I went to the Halwara, I went to the Ludhiana railway station.
Sir.
But no trains were moving.
Okay.
So I said, now what do?
Sir.
No buses were heading towards Pathankot side, going northward. They were all coming southwards.
Okay.
So I waited at the thing and there was a army ambulance train.
Acha, okay.
So I went and spoke to the doctor there and I said, can you give me a lift? Where are you going? He says, we are going towards Jalandhar.
Sir.
I said, can you give me a lift, please?
Okay.
Because I have to get to Pathankot.
Sir.
So they took me on the ambulance train and we reached Jalandhar railway station, Cantonment.
Sir.
And there again, no further movements.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the time I met a few officers who were going from Ambala.
Sir.
Going towards Amritsar.
Okay.
All of us were stuck over there now.
Mm-hmm.
So, fortunately, there was one army truck with Jawans going.
Sir.
I requested them. I said, where are you heading? He said, we are going upward north. I said, are you crossing Pathankot?
Sir.
So, they said, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So, I got a lift in that three-tonner.
Sir.
And by 5 o'clock in the evening, I reached Pathankot.
Mm-hmm.
That is also outside of Pathankot because they were taking a detour.
Mm-hmm.
Then I stopped a civilian fellow, took a lift on his scooter.
Okay.
He dropped me to Pathankot Air Force Station home.
Okay.
And I immediately took the scooter. I told the family, I'm sorry, I have to run to the squadron.
Squadron, yes, sir.
Yes. And I reached the squadron at that time.
Sir.
This was around 6:30 or so.
Okay. Evening, sir? 6:30 evening?
Evening, 6:30.
Sir.
So, by the time I reached there, I had found out that my course mate, flying officer Tyagi,
sir.
Sudhir Tyagi, he had gone on the very first mission in the morning.
Sir.
Along with the squad leader Rana.
Sir.
And they had gone to, I think, the airfield of Murid.
Murid, sir.
And there, they were attacked by their Mirage aircraft.
Mirage aircraft.
Just before the airfield itself.
Sir.
Like if you do a navigation, you go from, say, place A to place B.
Sir.
But before you go in for the attack, there is something called an initial point.
Okay, sir.
From there, you go to the target, in which is a short distance. So
sir.
That your navigation does not get disturbed.
Sir.
So, I think between initial point and the target, they were attacked by these Mirages.
Okay.
And they got into a dogfight.
sir.
With one mirage behind Squadron Rana.
Sir.
Flying also Tyagi behind that mirage.
Sir.
And another mirage behind Tyagi.
Okay, dogfight. Yes, sir.
Dogfight carried on. And in the meantime, Tyagi gave a call to Rana.
Sir.
That, sir, I've got that man.
Uh-huh.
Me the man who was behind Rana.
Okay.
But in the meantime, the mirage behind Tyagi got him.
Oh, uh-huh.
So he got shot down.
Okay.
And at that time, we were not sure as to whether he's alive or whether he's not.
Sir.
Rana came back and he told us about this.
Okay.
They had been attacked.
So Rana survived, sir, that attack.
He was responded to Rana, one of the flight commanders.
He survived. Yes, sir.
So he got back.
Yes, sir.
And Tyagi, unfortunately, got shot down there.
Oh, okay, sir.
In the evening, flying officer Chati, he had gone with Squadron Jam.
Sir.
To one of the airfields again, I think maybe Miyawali or...
Yes, sir.
And after the attack, while they were getting away,
sir.
One of the Pakistani aircraft got behind Chati.
Sir.
And he fired a very lucky shot because Chati was flying pretty low.
Sir.
He got a lucky shot on his aircraft and the aircraft pitched up.
Sir.
And Chati ejected.
Yes, sir.
Chati ejected over there and Jain came back.
Sir.
I had just reached there when Jain had come back.
Okay. Yes, sir.
We found that two of the pilots had been shot down.
Yes, sir.
From our squadron.
Sir.
And the other squadron, flying officer Muralidharan, had been shot down over Peshawar.
Okay. Uh-huh.
So,
the other squadron was also operating the same base, sir, Pathankot base.
Yeah. They were operating from Pathankot.
Okay. Yes, sir.
They were moved from Ambala to Pathankot just before, when the war started.
On 3rd, when
the war started, they came.
Sir.
And they had different targets, we had different targets.
Sir.
Now, after we got the debrief of what all had happened,
sir.
Then we went to our, we packed up for the day.
Sir.
And because unless and until you are told as to what is your next target, which sir. Will be told only in the ops room,
okay.
which you have to plan after that.
Okay, sir.
So we all went to the ops room and we were told that these are the likely targets, don't know, because it had not come from WC till then.
Sir.
So we got whatever maps were there, we got it ready to certain areas which we knew maybe it might be that. And went home.
Sir.
Now, what had happened was that on the third night at Pathankot,
sir.
Third night that I'm talking about.
Sir.
Now, Muralidharan and we had a flying officer Malkani.
Sir.
They was, you know, Pathankot had two officers' messes.
Sir.
Now, one was the number one officer's mess and they were staying in the number two officer's mess.
Sir.
Where they were also living out and except Murli, but Malkani was living out.
Sir.
Now, on third night, actually, one of the Canberras came and dropped their bombs over the number two officer's mess.
Okay, sir.
So their buildings got damaged and things like that.
Sir.
They were lucky that they were not staying there.
Were there any casualties, sir?
No, there were no casualties.
Oh, good.
But a lot of damage to the buildings.
Yes, sir.
Then Malkani, he was in my squadron.
Sir.
So I told Malkani, I said, "Why? Since you don't have a place to stay, you come and stay in my house."
Mm-hmm.
So Malkani came and stayed in my house. We went home. And spent overnight over there.
Sir.
And throughout the night, we could hear the Canberras coming and dropping bombs.
Okay.
And they were flying right over the house. So we used to close our ears wondering where the bomb is going to drop.
Okay.
Since we knew that they had already dropped the bombs over the officer, number two officer's mess.
Yes, sir.
I said, you never know, they might attack us.
Yes, sir.
So fortunately, one of the bombs fell behind my house.
Okay.
And shattered the house and things like that.
Okay.
And, but we were safe.
Okay.
So next morning, we got up and got ready to go. And my wife wanted to do a little puja, but Malkani pushed off.
Okay.
And I then reached the squadron, and then I was given my task that along with the flight commander, Coordinator Sondhi, I was detailed to go to attack Shorkot Road.
Okay, sir.
So, which is now I think it's called Rafiki now.
Okay.
That was called Shorkot Road at that time.
Sir.
And there were another mission going to Murid. There was one mission going to Miyawali.
Sir.
And Flight Lieutenant Rai who had already done an attack the previous evening over Sakesar SU, which is near Miyawali, was again along with Malkani to attack the same SU.
Sir.
Now, we went to our aircraft and I had started up the aircraft and I kept waiting over there.
Sir.
And when I found my leader was not, what had happened, he was not taxing out only.
Okay.
So we waited. So unfortunately, he called up and said my aircraft is unserviceable. So because he said the aircraft is unserviceable, now the mission was called off.
Okay.
Other missions went. Now, in that mission, Rai and Malkani,
sir,
to Kesar SU, and both of them got shot down over.
Oh my God! Okay.
From 20 Squadron,
sir,
there was Coordinator Mistry,
sir,
who was the flight leader of 20 Squadron. He went on. His number two had was unserviceable. He went alone.
Alone. Okay.
And all three got shot down over there.
My God! Same day. Same day. Sir.
But first Coordinator Mistry reached the SU,
sir,
and while he was putting in the attack, he got shot down.
Sir.
Then Rai and Malkani went, and Malkani got shot down over there.
Sir.
And Rai, what we believe, was trying to run away.
Sir.
But I think got shot down somewhere.
Okay.
Nobody knows exactly
how far. Run away after getting ejected, sir?
No, after the attack.
Achha, okay.
He was still in the aeroplane. He was
in the aeroplane. Yes, sir. Uh-huh.
When you say trying to run away, means you were still trying to run away in the aeroplane.
In the aeroplane, yes, sir. Okay.
You are not ejected.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay. But somewhere between that and the border,
sir,
he has been shot down over there.
My God. Okay.
And so we lost another two aircraft, another two pilots.
Uh-huh.
So we had a total of, on the first 2 days itself, four casualties.
Oh, okay.
Now, thereafter, we got information that the army was having a tough time,
sir,
in the Cham Jorian sector.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the village of Cham,
sir,
was initially captured during 75 war by the Pakistanis.
Sir.
That area is one area where we were a little weak in that area.
Sir.
And Pakistanis were a little strong in that area.
Sir.
That is why during 65 war also we lost out in that area only.
Okay, okay.
But during the handing over of territory, Cham was again handed over to us.
Acha.
But in 71 again we lost Cham.
Mm-hmm.
And between Cham and the river of Manavarthavi, a lot of our army people got trapped and killed over there.
Oh.
So there was...